Audio presents Scam Goddess, Lessons from a Life of Cons, Grifts, and Schemes. Written by Laci Mosley. Performed by Laci Mosley. I have to start this dedication by thanking God, aka my mother, Lori Bishop, for letting me scam her out of her body's resources in the womb. Pregnancy is crazy, y'all. Did you know you could lose teeth? Your nipple could fall off? You could birth a child who wants to be an actor? Only one of those things happened to my mom, and I'm so grateful that she poured her life, love, and savvy ways into me. To my grandmother, I just know they got audiobooks in heaven by now. Thank you for scamming me into loving myself. And to Isaac, I love you, Daddy. Introduction. I went missing when I was 5. LOL. The day I went missing started off like they all do, with me running the shower and getting clean for the day. I was always an adult-kid hybrid. Even at 5, I would shower on my own and my mom would just give me a quick sniff to make sure I was clean. She had taught me how to bathe well. Don't use the same towel you use on your body, on your face. Wash behind your ears. Don't forget your neck and your belly button. We're Black, so legs and other extremities were a given. After my shower, while my mom was getting ready for work, I'd hop on the sink and brush my teeth. Just two girlies getting ready for their jobs. At the time, my only job was figuring out how to get my mom to fund my dreams of becoming a performer. Well, that and going to kindergarten. But I cared more about performing. Ever since getting my first laugh at a family reunion that summer, I had become addicted to the sound of laughter. Then when my family started going on about how funny I was or how I was a natural-born performer, I knew I had found the thing I wanted to do with my life. It takes a certain amount of delusion, to want to enter the entertainment industry. And I'm lucky that I was born mildly crazy. I had no fear as a kid. Spending summers on a sprawling country road where your neighbors are also your family members and everyone loves each other gives you a sense of unflappable stability. I miss those days. The beginning stages of any dream is where the fun is. It's all potential. Potential is sexy. It's the thing we love in ourselves and other people. I had a lot of potential as a kid, and I wanted to utilize that potential. As soon as I realized performing was my calling, I sat my mom down and calmly explained that the natural next step, in my opinion, was to move to Hollywood. Reminder, I was in kindergarten, so my mom was like, "Hell no, I'm not going to drive you around to auditions and live out of my car and make my life all about you." Okay, Mom. It was clear that if I wanted something in this world, I'd have to figure out how to get it on my own. I knew that my mom was too resolute to be broken down by the traditional little kid whining, so I had to get creative. I gamed the system. In my mom's house, there was basically only one rule, and that rule was that I had to do well in school. So even at 5, I made school my number one priority. And because of this, my mom began to reward me with acting workshops, one of the greatest child exploitation scams. I personally do not think children should be employed, especially in the business I work in. Parents of child actors are fucking weirdos, and you can quote me on that. I work with child actors, a lot of them, and there's only one family that's not absolutely bizarre. You know who you are, or maybe you don't. That's the point. These people are willing to throw away their money and move into weird children acting encampments in LA, hoping their child will become the next Zendaya. It makes the child actor industry ripe for scamming because you have these crazed parents trying to will themselves into fame and fortune through their children. In these workshops, it's hard to tell whether what you're doing is actually getting somewhere or whether your kids suck. No one ever gives you a straight answer. You want to know if your kid has talent? Ask a Black person. Black people always speak the truth. Sure, I learned things from those classes and my mom managed to maintain healthy boundaries, but I feel like I'm a rare case. So school wasn't just school for me. It was an opportunity to unlock all of my acting dreams. Every morning, when I'd grab my school folder off the table, filled with teacher's notes and post-curricular writing exercises my mom would make me do for some of that extra home learning, I'd shake with the excitement of possibility. If I brought any good news home, I'd get to go to another acting workshop. On some days, if my mom was going in early to work, her forgettable husband, Mr. Tim, would drop me off. Seriously, y'all, this guy was just background in my life. I never paid much attention to Mr. Tim because it all went to my mom. Maybe I should have, though, because the day I went missing was a Mr. Tim day. As I walk toward the big glass double doors of Aiken Elementary, ready for learning with my blue uniform perfectly pressed, I noticed a white sheet of paper taped to the door. It was high above my head and the writing was too small to read, plus I was 5, so my reading was a work in progress anyway. I ignored the sign, hooked my little baby hand through the handle, and leaned back. Nothing. I pulled a little harder, but still, nothing. The door wouldn't budge. Then I noticed it. The quiet. I turned around only to see that the school grounds were completely empty. Not a single soul around. Not even Mr. Tim, who had dropped me off and skirt skirt away the second my feet hit the pavement. Damn, you couldn't wait to see if I got inside. Even Uber drivers do that. One star stepdaddy Tim. I turned back around and peeked through the glass windows only to see the hallways were empty too. If I had been tall enough, maybe a whole 6 years old, I would have been able to see that sign said the school was closed for a 3-day weekend. This was in an era where schools didn't use websites and parents didn't necessarily check their emails, so they sent kids home with notes and schedules like little carrier pigeons. But just like carrier pigeons, 5-year-olds have small brains and short attention spans. I'm sure my note was still sitting in my folder, exactly where my kindergarten teacher, Miss April, had left it the Friday before. In my defense, I was a good student, eager to please, so when Miss April had told me there was an important note for my parents in there, I had eagerly shoved my folder in the face of the first adult I saw, Mr. Tim. I'm sure he thought it was another gold star on a 4-word spelling test and didn't even bother to open the damn thing. Basically, I was fucked. Now, some 5-year-olds might have sat on the steps of the school waiting for an adult to save them, but not me. Mm-mm. I wasn't about to be a sitting duck just waiting for an abductor to come get me. I had watched enough Dateline with my grandma to know they didn't look for missing black girls. I had to stay on the move. A little kid with my charisma and adorable button nose? Yeah, I'd be snatched in a minute. I gripped my backpack straps in my hands and marched off the school premises, headed straight back to my apartment. The old saying goes, everything's bigger in Texas. And from a young age, I was always determined to be the biggest I could be. I carried myself as if I owned any place I stepped into. So it's no wonder people didn't seem to be alarmed by the sight of a 5-year-old business lady roaming the streets unattended. Those were my streets. When I got to my apartment complex a few blocks away, I felt a pang of relief. It wasn't in my nature to break rules and misbehave. I was what is known as a good kid. I went to church, loved school, and was completely uninterested in disobeying my all-seeing mother. My mom didn't allow me to do anything out of her sight unless it was school-related. I couldn't even sleep over anywhere because she was like, I've seen the movies. I don't need you getting murdered by some angry dad. I wasn't sheltered out of closed-mindedness or anything like that. I was sheltered out of protection. My mom knew my safety was insured in 3 places: her house, my grandparents' house, and school. Even though I loved spending time with my family, I was hungry to see more of the world. I was really intrigued by how other people lived because all I'd ever really known was my own little life in the guts of suburban Texas. The only time I wasn't under the strict supervision of a family member was when I was at school. So later on, I found a loophole, a way to break the rules while making it look like I was following them. I began signing up for after-school activities because technically that was still school. I joined the student council, then I became student council president and class president. Then I joined track, the volleyball team, cheerleading, and of course, theater. I did everything in my power to stay out in the world, learning, absorbing, making friends, doing things. Extracurriculars would become my portal to the great unknown beyond my mother's boundaries. Being in theater became a way to ingratiate myself with the very people I was so curious about. So yeah, wandering around Texas on my own as a 5-year-old was not really my MO. Even though I wasn't technically breaking any rules or doing anything bad, it felt wrong to be outside of school during the day with no supervision. I didn't think on it too much, though, because again, I was 5. I walked past a leasing office, the tennis courts, and a pool to the front door of my place and knocked. Now, okay, yes, if you're a grown-up reading this, then you'll already be like, Lacey, you know no one's gonna be home. It's the beginning of the workday. Protect those little knuckles, girl. But it took me a few minutes, many knocks, and then a few more minutes to realize no one was home. At this point, getting abducted began to sound more appealing to me. So I set off to do just that. Get abducted. I was already giving my best JonBenet, looking real milk carton, national newsworthy in my little blue uniform with the pleated skirt. I know they don't normally look for black girls, but with that fit and my big brown eyes, I was hoping they'd at least pretend. Laci Mosley. Come on, even my name is cute. There was a park next to my school, so I figured I'd start there. As soon as I arrived, I saw the perfect targets. Two little white kids with their Mexican nanny. Yes, bitch! They were going to make incredible abductors slash new family members. We could go home together and have a great life as a perfect American family. Two little white children, a Mexican lady, and a black girl. I puffed up my chest, put on my brightest smile, and walked right up to the kids. Hi, can I play with you? Confident, bold, in control. A good opening line. Could have used an introduction, but kids don't have that kind of etiquette yet. The kids instantly knew I was their adopted sister and acquiesced. I was thrilled. A new family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.